loves me. The Bible tells me so. I just love that little hymn. It was nice to hear it sung again in the meeting today. Now come with me in your Bible, please, to the letter to Titus, away at the back end of your Bible. Your 1st and 2nd Timothy and Titus, and then Philemon and Hebrews and James and so on. A little 3-chapter epistle, which is, to my knowledge, as far as I can see or understand, at times is neglected. We don't turn to it as much or as often as we should. But I'd like to do that today just for a time, in the meetings, just to whet your appetite, maybe to think about it, because the truths that are revealed in this epistle are truly amazing. Now, you can do one of two things with me this morning. You can read the scriptures with me, or you can simply sit and listen to what I want to do, because I want to take you through a number of verses that are found in the 2nd chapter. There's a reason why I want to do that. If you look at chapter 1 for a moment, and down at verse number 4 of the chapter, you find who this epistle is written to, from the apostle, to Titus, mine own son, after the common faith. So Titus had been led to Christ by the apostle Paul. I was preaching in a meeting here 2 weeks ago this evening, and I hadn't been to this particular church for way over 20 years. I'd never had the opportunity to go back. And you know, sometimes in a situation like mine, you get into an embarrassing corner and you don't know how to get out of it. But at the end of the meeting, this guy came up to me, a big, stout fella with a gray beard and gray hair like myself. And he looked at me and he said, "Brother Harvey, you know, there's always a closeness between the person that leads you to Christ and the person that's saved." And he says, "You know, I pray for you every day." And he said, "It's over 20 years ago now since you led the wife and I to the Savior." And I'm praying under my breath, "Lord, who is this?" I hadn't the faintest idea who the guy was at all. But then when he told me and explained what had happened during a mission in those parts many years ago, it was great to renew fellowship with him again. I'll make sure that I know him the next time. It can be just a little bit embarrassing if you don't. But here's Paul writing to his own son after the common faith. Now, he uses three words, and I'm not going to deal with the three words in the meeting this morning, because I do want to take one of them a little further in the meeting, God willing, tonight. But there's a trio of words here: grace, mercy, and peace. Now, if you ask me to distinguish between the three, we can do it like this. Grace is the act of God whereby he bestows upon me all that I never deserved as a sinner. Paul writing again to the Ephesians, "For the grace of God that bringeth salvation hath appeared to all men." Sorry, that's the epistle we're in. But in Ephesians he wrote, "For by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God." Now you can see God graciously giving things that we never deserved. But mercy is the opposite. Mercy is the act of God whereby he takes away from me all that I ever deserved. So in mercy, all I ever deserved is gone, and in grace, all that I never deserved has come. So you remember the apostle writing again, "But God, who is rich in mercy." And the hymn writer said about the cross, "That mercy there was great, and grace was free. pardon there was multiplied to me. There my burdened soul found liberty at Calvary. And of course, the other word in this little trio is a delightful word. It's the word peace. And when you get grace giving all and mercy taking all, the result is this, that we have peace with God. Therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God, and it comes through our Lord Jesus Christ. Now let's just finish the verse. The verse goes on to say, directing us to the source of all these blessings from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ our Savior. Now that's what I want to read there. Now if you come over to chapter number 2 for a moment, from verse 11 of the chapter down to the end of the chapter, the apostle begins to elaborate on this word grace. Now you know as well as I what grace is. Grace is God's free, unmerited favor, or if you like, it is God's riches at Christ's expense. Now in these verses, he lets us see what grace has miraculously and marvelously done and is yet doing for you and I who know Christ as Savior and Lord. Now, in verse 11, he brings before us what grace has brought. I'm doing this morning in a very simple way. He introduces the subject, for the grace of God. Now, we'll just leave that there at the minute, because as I said already, I want to come back to that possibly this evening. But he goes on to say this, that bringeth salvation. Now, isn't that something? Isn't it a wonderful thing today to be saved? No amens or hallelujahs or anything like that. Well, I'll try it again. Isn't it a wonderful thing to be saved? Good man. I don't know where that come from, but I'm glad somebody knows how to say it. Ah, friends, isn't it? Saved by grace alone. This is my only plea. Jesus died for all mankind, and Jesus died for me. And of course, if I'm talking to someone today in the service, and you are not saved at this minute, and this experience has not yet become yours, well, the Bible says now is the accepted time, and now is the day of salvation. And if you come to Christ where you are and open your heart and bring the Savior in, Christ will come in. You and he will walk out through that door together and along the pathway of life until eventually he either comes or calls. That's the wonder of God's salvation. Now, of course, we know this, that in our Bible there are three stages of salvation. I'll just mention them. You and I are saved who know the Lord today from the penalty of sin, and that comes through the death of Christ. You and I are being saved just now from the power of sin in our everyday Christian living. And that comes through the life that he now lives at the Father's right hand in glory. And of course, you and I are going to be saved from the presence of sin altogether when Jesus eventually comes again. So you can see the salvation story. It begins with Christ. It goes on with Christ. And it ends with Christ. It's Christ all the way through. Christ plus anything or minus anything is a perverted gospel. The gospel is Christ, and Christ is the gospel. Now, the remainder of this verse is delightful, because Paul says this, the grace of God that bringeth salvation hath appeared. It appeared when Christ appeared. It appeared when Christ was born. It appeared when Mary brought forth her firstborn son and wrapped him in swaddling bands and laid him in a manger. But the wonder is this: it appeared to all men. I was interested in listening to the introductory prayer there this morning, not only here but in the prayer meeting in the back room, to hear some of our friends praying for the missionary family. Very often, sometimes whenever people leave these lands and go elsewhere to preach the message of the gospel, it becomes a little bit out of sight and out of mind, which is never a good thing. But my friends, those who have left these shores and gone elsewhere with the glorious gospel have done it because of verses like this. The message is available, it has appeared, it is at the doorstep of all men. What a challenge that brings to those who do not have it, but what a challenge it brings to those of us who have salvation today to get out amongst all men and to tell them of Jesus, the mighty to save, and to do our best to win them for Christ ere the Savior comes again. For I believe with all my heart that the coming of the Lord draweth nigh. I was talking to another meeting here not so very long ago, and we were speaking on the Great Commission. You remember the commission the Lord Jesus gave to the apostles ere he returned to the glory? Go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. And then there's that marvelous promise: lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the age. What I was pointing out to them was this: it would almost look as if their fulfillment or their attempt to fulfill that promise or commission had failed, because none of those men ever went into all the world. They rarely stepped outside the land where they were born and the land where they lived. And what are we to take out of that? Go you into all the world. Well, you and I can help with that commission today. But you say, I have never been called to a land across the sea. I believe this, that the Christian needs a call to stay at home. The commission says go. But if the Lord has led you to remain here, then you need to reach the world at your doorstep. And you know, what an evangelical upsurge there would be if we could only get God's people inspired to reach the world where they live. I know a dear brother who lives away in County Armagh, and he's a character. His name is James. James says everything as he sees it. He's unique. You've got to know him. By this I mean, how did you get here today, James? I came by the MI instead of the M1. And you've got to think about what he's saying to you. I'll give you a ring in the telephony instead of the telephone. You see, whose are those buffaloes in that field? And you've got to think about this when you're with him. He's different. But I was standing in a shop in Craigavon one day waiting to pay for a few DIY things when somebody caught me like this. When I looked around, it was him. And I hadn't seen him for a good while. And he looked at me and he said this: boy, have I not been able to forget this. It has stuck in me to this day. He says, Brother Harvey, are you ready for the liftoff? Now, that's what he called the second coming of the Lord. The liftoff. Are you ready? And that set me thinking. Am I really? Have I done what he asked me to do? Am I reaching out to sinners? And that came as a challenge to me. Have we been true to the trust he left us? Do we seek to do our best? If in our hearts there is naught condemns us, we shall have a glorious rest. That man James I'm telling you about is a principle. And the principle is this: he will not go to a gospel meeting without bringing unsaved people with him. He won't do it. And he always is there, and he always has somebody or more than one in to hear the message of the gospel. I admire that. If only we could stir the people of God to do that. And even for your meeting tonight, to come yourself and bring one or two or three. If you're driving a car and you're on your own, fill it. Bring them in, and they'll hear the message. And who knows, this could be the very night when they could be saved. It hath appeared to all men what grace brought. Now, I want to take you back to school in the next verse, because in the next verse, he brings us to what grace taught. In other words, when you're saved by grace alone, you go back into the school of God, and God teaches you, and you begin to learn. And of course, we need a teachable spirit. Now, watch how this is phrased. It hath appeared to all men, teaching us. So it moves from the all to the us. The all is universal, but the us are those that are saved. And once you're saved, you come into the school of grace, and God has things to teach you. Let me say this particularly to young believers in our meeting this morning. You and the grace of God will never be over until you make it to heaven. You'll never know it all. God will always have something more to teach you. Always. Have a teachable spirit and learn of him, and you'll become an invaluable asset to the work of God. Now, teaching us what? Well, there are two negatives here. I'm not going to go into them in any great detail. He says, teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lusts. Now, I don't think this is either the time or the place for me to deal with ungodliness and worldly lusts. I think you would know only too well what the apostle is possibly referring to. There's a lot of ungodliness around. There's a lot of worldly lusts around. But Paul says, denying them. Don't get involved. No matter how much someone may coax you or try to persuade you, don't give in. God's grace will enable you to stand fast. Deny ungodliness and worldly lust, an inroad into your life. Now that word deny, it carries with it also the thought of denounce. Now let me say this, that unless you're denying something, an inroad into your life, you cannot denounce it. But if the thing that you want to denounce is not in your life under any circumstances, then you can denounce away at it. But there's no point in you smoking a cigarette, I'm taking an extreme example, and denying the use of nicotine. There's no use in you drinking Guinness and telling others they shouldn't do it. It doesn't work. Before you denounce it, you must deny it. That's how it is. Watch how you live. You know, I spent many years in evangelistic work, something that lies very dear and very close to my heart. And when you go out around the doors, friend, you make a lot of discoveries. But one thing, or maybe two things that I discovered, two things that we could look at just for 1 minute as one, could be this. That if I went onto the doors and I discovered a person who was really living for Christ, their life may have been a rebuke to their neighbors, but they were admired. And people admitted it. Time and again I heard, if only I had what that person has. I heard that over and over and over again. But then if somebody is professing to be a Christian and they're not living the life, boy, did the world delight in throwing that in my teeth. They sure did. And oh, the harm that it does. The harm. I remember, this is one against myself, having a gospel mission in Trillick one time. That's a wee bit from here. But I was out on the doors, and I came across this laneway leading up to a farm. And I had been warned about this old grumpy fella who lived up this lane. Now, I don't know whether you have any old grumpy boys in Kilkeel or not, but I've met quite a few of them in my time here, there, and yonder. I've always had the ambition never to be one of them. I hope I can achieve that to the end of the journey. But anyway, I went into the yard, and this old fella come out. What do you want? Well, I says, I'll tell you what I want if you put them two dogs away out of the road. They're two big Alsatians showing me every tooth in their head. Well, I said, he put them away into a shed, and I got out and began to talk to him. Who are you? I told him my name. What do you want? I've come to invite you to the mission. Right? Are you the man from the cloth church? I'd never heard of a cloth church in my life. That's what he called the tent. You the man from the cloth church? I said, yes. Where do you come from? Are you married? Have you a family? And I thought, what's going on here? Tell me no more. I said, right. He says, I'm going to the mission. But he says, the less I know about a preacher, the better I enjoy him. Well, think about that one for a minute or two. So he was getting all the information he needed. Didn't want to know any more. Now, can you see where he's coming from? Can you? The harm that's done by people not living right. The harm. Now, Paul says, look, Titus, look, believers in Kilkeel today, make sure that you're denying ungodliness and worldly lust. And then you can denounce it with every breath you breathe if you care so to do. Two negatives. But then he comes to three positives. And he saith this in the verse, that we should live. Now, if a person is delving into ungodliness and worldly lust, they're not living, they're only existing. There's no real life there. None at all. You could have seen people maybe going up and down the street here last night singing their head off, I don't know. And they think this is great. They woke up this morning with a thumping headache. Where's the life in that? None at all. None whatever. That's not what God desires. But there are three things here that you should live soberly. Now, what's that all about, living soberly? That's a right relationship with yourself. Self-control. What about that? Have you got self in subjection to the Lord? Living soberly? Had you a bad temper? Do you still lose it easily? Remember an old fellow saying to me one time, his name was Billy. He's in heaven today, so he probably won't be able to hear me. But he said to me, I lost my temper. I said, you're telling lies, man. He says, I did. I lost my temper. I said, if you'd lost it, didn't take you long to find it. The things people come out with. Not soon angry. That's what's here. Don't run about losing your temper. What use is that? The harm it does. The harm. My father was a fisherman from Port of Hogie. And I don't know what you would have done to make him angry. I just don't know. There was times, I admit, when I tried it. And it never once worked. Now, I couldn't say that for her. She was a bit more fiery. But my father was unique that way. I never, ever heard a cross word from my father in my life. I was nearly going to ask a show of hands of some of you boys who could say amen to that. I don't dare do it, you see. But that's a fact. He is a very even-tempered man. My father was the first convert that the late Hedley Murphy had. And my father was saved as a sign that God wanted that man to go out into full-time service. I could tell you a story about that. But Hedley told me one day, he said, you know what your father's problem was for years? For he wasn't saved 2 years after me. I said, no, well, he says, I'll tell you. He said, your father was a Christian before he was saved. He says, you couldn't have pointed your finger at him. And neither you could. You could not have pointed a finger at his life. He walked a straight pathway as any man ever has seen. And one day he found out that it wasn't good enough. Thank God he needed the Savior. Keep yourself in subjection. You just have a look at the mirror when you go home. Have a good look at it now. And whenever you look into that mirror, say to yourself, I need to watch me. I do. And be very careful about criticism. Do you know what criticism is, friends? I'll tell you. Criticism is the mirror image. Let me illustrate what I mean. I'm doing a mission one time in an area, and there was this lady, and I never met anybody so critical in all my life. And I was getting sick of her. I really was. And I thought, I'm going to have to sort that out somehow. So there was one day I was out visiting in the area, and I saw a lady going up a hill on a motorbike. Not a motorbike, a push bike. But it was like a motorbike. I'd never seen anybody could push a bike like her. And when I got up to the top of the hill, here she was in this house, and I invited her out to the mission. And she told me that she would come. And she did, and she got saved at the mission. But when I went back to the house, I happened to be saying about meeting this rather remarkable lady. And the lady looked at me, oh, she says, her, she's not half wise. Well, I'd had enough. And I looked at this lady, I said, do you know who you know, how you know that? No, she says, I don't. Well, I said, I'll tell you. I said, you're the other half. I said, when you look at her, you see you and you can't keep your mouth shut. And that's very often what criticism is. When you look at someone, you see yourself and you can't keep quiet. Now you have a far better to. The next time you hear somebody criticizing, just remember what I've said and take a careful look at it. And you'll find out 9 times out of every 10 I'm right. Absolutely. Learn to keep your mouth shut. The wise old owl sat on an oak. You hear it again? The more he saw, the less he spoke. The less he spoke, the more he heard. And people should imitate the wise old bird. Boy, those old sayings are good. A lot of truth in them. Ungodliness. Worldly lust. Living soberly. Righteously. That's a right relationship with my neighbor. Yesterday, I was thinking, and I was thinking about a verse or a text or part of a verse, really, that I've never ever preached on because I'd find it difficult. And I was thinking I must give this a go sometime. Love your neighbor as yourself. What's all that about? Well, that's what's meant by that word righteously. And you see, it works out like this. If I'm a neighbor to unconverted people, and I don't have a testimony whereby I can ask them to a gospel mission, and they'll come, there's something not right somewhere. Because they would need to have a desire for what I have, because they've seen it in me. Many years ago, I was preaching in a meeting one Sunday morning, and there was a man doing a children's talk. And in the course of his children's talk, he brought a piece of wood onto the pulpit, and he had screwed a bulb, a socket, onto the piece of wood with a long lead and a plug, and he put a bulb on. And when he came up, he connected the plug in, and there was a connection on the pulpit, and turned on the bulb. And he gave a children's talk about this bulb. Now, I can't remember what he talked about, to be honest. But I'll never forget what he said at the end. He said, boys and girls, since I came up here, I have talked and given you details about this bulb. But you know something he said? The bulb has never spoke a word. It has just shone. You got that? I never forgot that. The bulb has never spoke a word. It has just shone. And if you never speak a word, let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven. I'm not going to get this finished, so I think the best thing to do is pull the horns and go back to it maybe tonight in the meeting as I find the Lord leading, because there's so much in this. But I'll complete this verse. Soberly, righteously, and godly. I couldn't help thinking, had I written this, which of course I didn't, would I have worded it like this? Would I have put godly last? I don't think so. I think I would have been inclined to put it first. But Paul put it in third place. Not that he was despising it in any way. Now, whether I'm right or wrong in my interpretation of this or not, I don't know, but I'm going to give you what I feel the reason is. If I haven't got myself under control, and if I haven't got a right relationship with my neighbor, how on earth can I claim to be right with God? Don't think it works. I'd rather see a sermon than hear one any day. I'd rather one would walk with me than merely show the way. And though the sermons you deliver may be very good and true, I'd rather learn my lesson by observing what you do. There's a ladder here. Soberly, self-control, righteously, your neighbor, loving your neighbor as yourself, godly, God first, and people recognizing it by the way you live. That's what it's about. Be like the bulb and make sure you shine. One final thing, for the time's gone. In this present world, you know, friends, the world passeth away, and the lust thereof. But him that doeth the will of God abideth forever. I was standing as I came in this morning, looking at some of your photographs down there in that back porch, some of the old black and whites. And our brother was pointing out some of the people to me that were on that photograph that I knew in the past. But I think I would be right in saying this, that probably the majority of them are not here anymore. Probably. When I went to Killikameen all those years ago, there was a number of people there. It wasn't a big fellowship by any manner of means. But when I left, there was only one of the old people left. That was all. Proving that the world passeth away, and the lust thereof. Someday, we'll not be here. Someday, you and I will be gone. Someday, the place that know us now will know us no more forever. That is if the Lord tarries. I wonder what sort of a testimony we leave behind us. The grace of God. It's all available to enable us to live right, to be right, and to serve the Master right, and to do it with gladness and singleness of heart. I'm stopping there just now. May the Lord bless you and help you to walk with him. There's what it brought and what it taught. There's some other things. I may take them in the meeting tonight as I feel the Lord leading. May the Lord bless you and his word to every heart. Now,